everyone. Good evening. I'm just going to give it a couple minutes to make sure everyone can get in and settled. We have a large group tonight, so this is all very exciting. I just want to make sure, can everyone see the colorful presentation that says Beyond 2020? Just give me a thumbs up. Great, thank you. And also, if you are an artist that's in the show, if you haven't already, can you put your name in your Zoom so that if we want to single someone out? Jared, I see you. Jared, your name is good. Just give a wave. Yes. Thank you, Jared. Hi, Rosie. I haven't seen you in a long time. I miss you. Hi. Look at all these names. It's so great. It's so great to see everyone.
I can't see anyone.
Is that working?
Mm-hmm. Oops. Hold on.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
Okay.
No, it didn't work.
Well, you got to hit rename.
Okay.
You got to hit.
Yeah, I did.
No?
Yeah.
There we go.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I think we'll start in 1 minute. I just want to make sure everyone can get on.
Still the wrong lighting. Good idea. Let's see if I can get it.
Okay, well, wonderful. Thank you. Thank you for your patience. This is our first.
I can bring you the headphones.
First Friday that's virtual. So, excuse us for any hiccups. We're trying to recreate kind of the community that we have online. I mean, community we have in our building, but online. So, again, welcome. Thank you for joining us for the virtual opening of our 99th anniversary Beyond 2020 exhibition. I'm Allie Gould, the marketing director at Pacific Art League. For those of you who don't know about Pacific Art League, and this is the first time you're joining us, we are a nonprofit community-based arts organization serving the Bay Area. Our mission is to develop art programs and exhibits that will make an impact in our community. And like most local community organizations and businesses, we have been impacted by the pandemic. Our artist community has been impacted the most. The silver lining is that we've been able to reach a much broader audience with our new online programs and with this exhibit, Beyond 2020. So again, thank you for joining us, all the participating artists. Thank you for submitting your work. With every submission, there was a donation, and we appreciate it so much. And we just love all the work that we have hanging up in our gallery in the windows and also online. This show is open now. It's actually on our website now, and it's in the windows. And it'll be rotating on it'll rotate twice a month. So different artists will have different positions in the windows, and it's opened until December 31st. Oops, sorry about that, hold on. My mouse got away from me. And so proceeds from this show go directly to the artists and to PAL. And, you know, other ways to support the show is visit the gallery, come to the window side gallery that we have set up at PAL. Our gallery manager, Donnie Foley, has done an incredible job setting up walls along Ramona and Forest Street where people can now visit the show within safe distance and outside. And also, if there's an artist that you see tonight, connect with them, reach out to them on Instagram or Facebook, or if you want to contact them directly, let us know. Contact Donnie or I, we're happy to connect you. Artists love to know their work's appreciated, and it's a great way to make a connection. Also, register for a class or workshop at PAL. We have so many great classes online right now. No matter where you live, you can participate in our community. Also, you can become a PAL member, which is a great way to connect. And last, through this exhibition, we are raising funds for a fund in need, which is that we're building an outdoor space on Ramona Street in front of our entrance where we can welcome our community back. We can't hold classes right now indoors, so we're planning on holding classes outdoors. and also different ways to celebrate our artists through exhibits and other socials that we can hold outside. So please, again, donate to that. We're raising money to build this because, again, we want to bring us all back into the building safely. And as for donors, we've already had wonderful donors donate to this show and to the fund. And thank you to all of them. And of course, we would love to have more. And donors will be featured on our website. And if you make a donation tonight of more than $25, or if you become a PAL member, we will send you a commemorative PAL Beyond 2020 poster that you see here from two of our exhibiting artists. So real quick, the highlights of tonight's reception. We have Kay Culpepper, the exhibition chairwoman, giving opening remarks, along with the Avid Bank Selection Award. I will introduce you to our jurors. They will make the prize announcements. And also Robin Scholl will be giving some comments about the Kathy Zander first place recognition. And from there, the Best in Show will be announced, followed by an artist presentation. It's about a 10-minute video slideshow of all the works that will be shown. All the works that are in the show. And these works are also on our website. So if you don't have time to stick around for the video, just go to our website, pacificartleague.org / Beyond 2020, and you can enjoy the exhibit there. But before we go on to Kay Culpepper, I actually have a surprise for Kay. We have Hazel Keelan, a PAL board member and artist, instructor who would like to say something. Hazel?
Thank you, Ali. And firstly, thank you, Ali. Ali and Donnie on the staff and Heba behind the scenes have done a fabulous job putting this all together. So first of all, can we say a big thank you to the staff at Pacific Art League who've really been on the line since COVID struck and just put their heart and soul into keeping PAL alive for all of us. So thank you, Ali, Don and Heba, and any volunteers that you've had working with you. So I want to raise a glass, wine, orange juice, water, tea, air, whatever you have, to the lady who's really all made this happen. So stand up, Kay Culpepper. So Kay has been the inspiration for us on the committee. She's been energized. She's absolutely passionate about art and the Pacific Art League and bringing this community together. So please, can we raise our glasses to Kay? And thank you, Kay, for keeping us all on track and for everybody on the committee. And let's have a really lovely evening together. It's so nice to see you all and to be part of this community. Thank you. Cheers.
Thank you, Hazel. Thank you. Well,
With that said, welcome, Kay Culpepper.
Shall I begin?
Yes.
Thanks. Thank you, Hazel. That was wonderful. And I would say the same back to this entire committee, but we'll get to that. My job is to tell you a little bit about the show, the history, and what's going to happen next in a more detailed way. So I want to welcome you again. As Ali said, it's our first virtual opening in our 99-year history. Next year will be 100. So the reason we've had this show every year since we celebrated the 94th anniversary is that we felt that we needed to have a countdown to being 100 years old. And it's going to be a big excitement next year when that happens. But this is our first in many ways. So for me, exhibition is the face of the League of Artists. It seems to be the culmination of all of our efforts, and it's who we are, how we feel, and how we express it. And every one of the paintings I saw today in the windows downtown are unique. All of the pieces, sculptures, and so on, you should go. There were people competing already for what they wanted to buy. So it's a big attraction. I really enjoyed seeing one of the artists and a fan of art vying for certain paintings and certain other things that are incredible. So this year, to say the least, presented quite a challenge. but we really wanted to do this show because it just felt right. And yet it was hard because we were dealing with a sudden and frightening pandemic, the sadness and pain of social discord, climate catastrophes, which we can't go out now and take a deep breath even today, and so many losses. So we've all been shaken by this. And as time went by, it became more apparent that having this exhibition seemed like an imperative. We needed more than ever to see expressions by artists and of art that never fails to heal. And I felt like I was walking on air today when I saw the windows just filled with color and form. And I thank you, Donnie, for that. So we had to think outside the box, but we also had to think outside the building because we weren't allowed to go back in. And really, I think Donnie created this design of pictures in the window. And this event could not have happened without an amazing committee that contains members from every aspect of the Art League. And that would be, I want to first say, it started with the encouragement of our president of the board, Ellie Javadi. She was a fan of getting the exhibition back online and back on in space. So that's the beginning. But the rest of this creative and energetic committee was made up of volunteers, members, artists, instructors, board, and staff, all working together. I'm sure the staff had to volunteer a little bit too. And they were, and these are the members of the committee: Joy Chase, Helen Jew, Hazel Keenan, Rashida Khan, Robin Scholl, Lori Shoemaker, and Josephine Schuster, plus the staff members who are vital to this effort. We couldn't do it without you, and all the rest of these creative people. But that would be Allie Gould, your moderator, and Donnie Foley. So here we are. And the great thing about it is not only did this challenge cause us to grow and expand in different ways, but it gave us the opportunity to reach even more artists and art lovers than we ever anticipated. And it gave us the chance for coming together again, reuniting, engaging as a community on an even broader scale than we would have in our little galleries. So the one focus that I had this year, besides making a gift to the community, was to provide more benefits to artists than we have ever offered in the past. And these are a few of those benefits. All the work was accepted for the online exhibition, and artists from every point in the Bay Area will receive 60% in sales. There was an option for sponsorship for entry. And one of the most important things that artists value, highly esteemed jurors. And you will hear about them very shortly. But I think the jurors attract so many wonderful artists. When they see who's looking at the work, they come. And they have done that. So they are also chose the 100 top 100 to have in the hanging gallery, and awarded, and I had to alter this, 10 fabulous awards. Is that right, Rick? Because it's 5 honorable mentions and the other awards you'll hear about from the jurors. But I just want to say, artists, this exhibition is about you. The artists who joined us in an effort to bring this amazing visual experience online and on the corner of Ramona and Forrest. And it's, we celebrate you and we thank you. And it is also about our entire community. It's a gift to the community from all of us who participated, I think. And we invite the Bay Area to join us and enjoy both of the exhibitions. Come walk by the sidewalk. You will be amazed. And go online, because that gallery has all of the entries for sales and viewing. And congratulations to all of you artists. And thank you for bringing us all together again.
Thank you, Kay. Thank you so much.
You are.
So let's get on to the awards. So the first award is actually, it's our sponsor award, which is Avid Bank. And unfortunately, Ken Brenner couldn't be here tonight. Avid Bank and Ken Brenner have been strong supporters of the Pacific Art League. Ken Brenner is the head of strategic relationships at Avid Bank, and he's also a practicing artist. And he has, he's been such an amazing partner, both on our board of advisory and being an artist that participates just like the rest of you in our shows. And we gave him the honor of being able to select a winner. And they are also a sponsor of this show. And Ken wasn't able to be here tonight, so I'm going to present on his behalf. And he has selected as the winner for the Avid Bank Award, Kai Lun Q. Kai, I think I saw you. I'm not too sure. We're going to try to spotlight you if you can raise your hand and wave. So Ken said he chose this painting because, you know, look at the notes. He chose the painting because it was technically sound, but it also had an overall appealing aesthetic that blended the abstract and the real world. He felt the cat brought a sense of peace and softness that the world needs right now. So congrats, Kai.
Oh, thank you. Oh, wow, this is, dang, I didn't expect this. Oh, I'm glad I showed up. Thank you.
Thank you, Kai. Kai's also a PAL instructor. You just started this summer, so we're very happy to have you, and congrats.
Oh, thank you so much.
Yeah. So moving on, I'm excited to introduce to you our jurors. So our two jurors have deep connections to PAL. The first juror is Chun Wei Hu, and the other one is Rick Ambrose. So Chun Wei is, she's a world-renowned artist. She teaches at PAL, but she also exhibits around the world extensively in China, Taiwan, Japan, and the United States. She has a solo show coming up at the Triton Museum that opens October 24th. I recommend you that you look at Chun Wei's website. It is incredible. I mean, I can't even go through her accolades because it would just take too long. And, you know, hopefully we can all visit the Triton show when it opens. So I just wanted to say, Chun Wei, do you want to say hello?
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, this is Chun Wei. Thanks, Ali. It is a big honor for me to be one of the jurors for this event. And I'd like to thank the exhibition committee for your trust and support. And special thanks to Ali, Donnie, for your hard work and help and support. And very special thanks to Rick for your expertise to make the process very smooth and happy and very efficient. And I'd like to congratulate all the participants because you are all the winners because for your love to art and you for your support to PAL and for the extra step that you take to challenge yourself. So I think everybody is a winner. Congratulations to everybody. And you have made the event successful. Thank you.
Thank you, Chun Wei.
Thank you.
Next, I'd like to introduce Rick Ambrose. So Rick is represented in numerous public and private collections. His large-scale drawings were featured in solo and group exhibits across America. He has over 30 years experience in managing art collections of historical and contemporary art. And he was actually the Pacific Art League executive director for several years and did an incredible job. And many of you may remember him from his tenure there. But we're very happy to have him back involved in this show. It's always a delight to work with Rick. And also I want to mention before you start, Rick, that you've had two pieces accepted into the D Young Open recently. So congrats.
First of all, I want to thank everyone. First, Donnie Foley, who really worked with both Chen Wei and myself in putting all the images together. And I want to talk a little bit about the jury process. And then I would then have the pleasure of announcing the award winners. The jury process is like most any process is where the juror or jurors in this case will look at a number of pieces. And if you remember back in some decades ago, it used to be that the jury would look at the actual work. The artist would have to bring the work to the gallery, get jury, and then either if the piece is picked, it stays for the exhibition, or if not, the artist would have to take it home. And that's always a difficult part for the artist and disappointment as well. And then the technology with slides came about and more jury shows were done by slides. The problem with slides is it doesn't really capture the actual size of the image, the texture, or the work, the technical skills of the artist. And now we have a new, somewhat with digital, we have JPEGs and now we have a new platform, online exhibitions, jury exhibitions. Due to the pandemic and probably a new technology and possibly a platform that will be part of presenting art to the world. Of the nearly 200 pieces, what we did was we each jury and selected 100 pieces. We were asked to jury in 100 pieces. We did it separately. Then we compared our results. And of the 100 that each one of selected, 53 were voted by both jurors. So we were left to pick 47 pieces to come up with 100. And what we did was we looked at the pieces that got at least one vote. And there were 67 of them. And so that's when, during the meeting, we would go each one several times and decide yes or put in a question or go ahead and accept it. And finally, we were able to come up with the 100 pieces. And then everyone was notified of results of the jurors. Then just yesterday, after Donnie hung the exhibition, we arrived at Pell and we went through and we looked at the work carefully and we put our postmarks as to which one should get an award. And then we look at all our postmarks and say, okay, let's narrow it down. And it was very difficult to narrow it down to just three honorable mentions. So we decided to increase that number to 5. And to be honest, the selections, as tough it is, and particularly picking first place, second place, third place, you know, any given day, usually the jury might even pick a different piece. And that's very common because it's the moment of looking at the work that really strikes a spark in them and making that decision. And that's what makes it interesting. The art has a life of its own. It's not just the physical object. So in narrowing everything down, we were able to make our choices, final choices. And then I've been asked to make the presentation. And what I'd like to do is not only announce the winning artist, but also talk just a minute or two about what I see in the piece and what strike my interest in picking that piece for that particular award. So we're going to move on to the honorable mentions, and there were 5 honorable mentions in any order. So we're going to go with the first one. And this is by a photographer. I knew Gergen Weston. It is Murmurations number 3. This is an artist who goes out in the world and photographs at unusual angles. And she considers herself sort of a minimalist herself. The magic happens when she takes the images into her studio and then captures certain moments. And what she does with most of her images, she intentionally blurs them, sort of a time-lapse image. It almost like in this particular piece is very, black and white, you see a few figures, silhouette figures walking through space, walking through a corridor. So in essence, it's a caption of, its photography captures a single moment. In this case, it captures time, maybe 2 or 3 milliseconds. So you can sense that there is a presence, a past, presence, and future in way it captures this moment. And also it creates a new pattern, a look at how human activity surrounds it. So that's what really I felt about this particular piece. And congratulations to the artist. Next is, this is Degraded DNA by Eric Mahie. This is a very large painting. It's a very unusual composition. So you can see that the figure of the head is at the bottom of the painting. Rather, normally it's usually in the middle or higher at the top. And this is a large void above the head. And there's a line across the, about almost not at midpoint. And so this three-quarter stark portrait of, I think it's the artist, and has glares at you. And it's a sense it kind of epitomized the moment, what we are going through, all of us, this tension, anxiety. And that strand up there is a, like a delicate thread that's unraveling. There are two strands unraveling, or maybe it's weaving together, we don't know. And so it kind of reminds me that dark space above, it could be empty space, but it's activated by this thread. And there's a term, an old term that art historians would use, where you activate empty space, it is called pregnant void. So he did this successfully. So I want to thank Eric for this particular piece. This is a watercolor on rice paper, Dwelling in Green Mountain by Isabella Ye. She is a student of our juror Chun Wei, and also a student of Paul Ho. And Paul Ho, what many of you remember, that he taught one of the master Chinese watercolor painters of the 20th century, taught art classes every Saturday, I believe, at Pacific Art League for over 50 years. But this is a typical depiction of the world of the combination of Western and Eastern aesthetics. In this case, it is color and is floating on the surface. It's almost the world as a floating world. And then there is this sort of tension between foreground, midground, and background. And then there's a little village in the far. So, but typically Chinese art, the power of the brush, the mark itself carries the soul of the painting. And the sense of space is stacked. So foreground is the bottom, midground, and then background. They're stacked that way. They don't overlap each other. But there's a little sense of Western space that's included in it. So this is a wonderful watercolor by Isabella. This is Nathalia, I believe, Strand. This is called River Styx. It's a photograph. It's mounted on metal. And it's a very unusual environment. It's like some containment where there's water on the foreground. There's a woman who's stretched out arms like it's trying to raise the ceiling or trying to get above the ceiling, but something's prohibiting her to get above. And so there's this sense of void and almost the sounds. You can't even hear the sounds, but you know that something's happening in that space. And in this way, it's almost taking the negative of the photograph and making it a positive. That's what she does with her images, most of her images. So you get this eerie light and this surreal space. Okay. And this is for Tom Green. He's the artist of this called Fort Point, which is under the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco. And you notice that is this stark contrast of dark and white and some subtle grays. And you can see that it's very unusual. In some ways, you might think, well, this artist must have put two images together. This is Photoshop. It's not. I mean, it's extreme lighting, yes. But you see this is sort of minimalism in terms of tonality. And there's an emphasis on the architecture, the ribbing of the Golden Gate, the arches. And then there is a figure who's just peering out of shadow that's an almost highlighted that's there in the, you know, sort of across the plaza. This reminds me some of the Bauhaus photography of the 1930s, this brutal emphasis on long and form and simplicity. And now we go to third place. We are now going to third place. We'll mention second place, first place, and best of show for third place. And the third place winner will receive a $200 cash award. And that goes to Elizabeth Lada. So I know Eliz, she was a staff member at the Pacific Art League. when I was there, and that she and I have, we have done some catalogs together. She helped design some of the catalogs for the Richmond Arts Center. But in this piece, and I knew that her as artist, this is a riveting piece. This is a piece of a nurse, I'm sorry, it's blocking the title, Amanda Ramu, COVID nurse in Brazil. And if this piece is purchased, the artist mentioned that if this piece is purchased, that all the proceeds will go to the clinic in Brazil that Ramada Roma, who is working at. And this particular image is the classic image of the era that we live in today. This is a person who wears the torture, the anxiety, the worriness of what's going on in the pandemic world. I mean, it's brutal reality. There's a clash of reds and blues and greens that stare into her eyes, just encapsulates you and resonates throughout. And it's going to be a slightly different picture of another portrait we'll see later. So this is very, expressionistic and has all the qualities, the scars. It is, it's a moment. So this, it's really a classic image of what we see in media, in this case, what we see of all the frontline workers who have to deal with the virus. And this, congratulations to Liz.
Thank you, Rick.
Now, second place is, this is a landscape painting. It's a view from the train, Nizu. This is a painting of a landscape from above a bluff and is diagonally cut into where the foreground is in shadow, dark shadow, and then the background, the upper half, is in this light, this golden flood of light. It kind of reminds you that in certain weather conditions, after a heavy storm, and when the sun is about to set and it pierces through the clouds, and suddenly you get this golden hue. And reminds me of the metaphor of the city on the hill. And the work, if you have to get really see this piece in person, because a lot of the heavy impasto the artist applies on and all the surfaces, and you can look very close and you see a chaotic arrangement of dashes and splashes of paint using either a brush or types of brush or palette knife, or I'm sure it is his finger or her finger, and making up the abstract forms. But from a distance, it gives you this sort of sense of utopia. And congratulations. Now, before we go on to the first place, I wanted to move the discussion to Robin Scholl. She's going to be talking about Catherine Zander Award.
Robin, we have to unmute you. Robin, hold on. Or if you can unmute yourself. There you go.
Okay, thank you. So on August 15th of this year, we lost a truly beloved member, friend, instructor, and supporter of the Pacific Art League, Kathy Zander, after a years-long struggle with ALS. Kathy was a very accomplished artist, most notably with a master's in art from Purdue and service on the board of Silicon Valley Open Studios for many years. I gladly and quickly accepted the opportunity to speak about her and why the committee wanted to honor Kathy. I'm honored to do so, and I want to add that this award in Kathy's name should happen in all future anniversary shows. Thinking back over the 20 plus years that I've known her, the thing that amazes me the most is how much she really embodies what the Pacific Art League is all about. Her endless hours of volunteering at all of our events is just the beginning. She would consistently show up just before events, and when we were rushing around tearing our hair out with the logistics, she was always right there on time to offer a hand, whether it was bringing food, hanging artwork, or doing the dishes. Kathy was always eager to help. Then, of course, her fabulous artistic talent and devotion to teaching was surely something to admire. I think the best example of this was when she got to teach the veterans at the Palo Alto VA Hospital. with her skill and marvelous empathetic nature. It was a natural, and I loved her over there. She always managed to help me out if I was sick and couldn't teach my classes. And this type of person is hard to come by. Her openness to learning about all kinds of techniques in painting should also be admired. Or in this life, don't we all need that to be that well educated and ready to try new things? All in all, I have a photo of her in my studio that I can see each day when I begin to paint. It motivates me. It reminds me about how valuable and treasured friends can be. It motivates me to remember to help people if they need it, to wear a smile, even though we may not always be smiling inside, to volunteer and give of your time, and to really treasure your art. You don't necessarily know how much more time you will have to do this. So thank you, Kathy, for all you did to make PAL the special place it is. And congratulations to the first place award winner.
Very good, Robin. I remember that when I was at the Pacific Art League, I had the pleasure of helping her hang her solo show at the Pacific Art League. I can't remember which year it was. And we talked a lot about our time in the in college, where she went to Purdue and I went to University of Oregon, about the challenges of being a young student and trying to make a mark. So on her behalf, I'm pleased to mention the winner of the first place award, and this person will receive a $500 cash, is the Frontline, a painting about 12 by 24 inches, Yoming Kate. This is a very powerful image, not only in the execution of the paint, the form, but it resonates as more of a metaphor than a real image. What's interesting about this is the nurse, the woman who's striding forward confidently and demanding as a leader, follow me. There's something that's gravitating to this piece. It kind of reminds me of some of the heroic images that past masters would use in their paintings. And this is kind of like the Eugene Delacroix, Liberty Leading the Women during the 1830 Revolution, French Revolution. And this would be almost like a part of, because we don't know whether she's floating there, because we don't know if she's on land. So there's that sort of a suggestion that could be used as sculpture. That's in some ways, you could put it as a piece, as a symbol of what's going on today, particularly in 2020, not only about the pandemic, but also the anxiety, and also that there's an element of confidence in her and hope. And that's, I mean, it's not just the beautiful rendering, the folds of the drapery of the garment, but it is her poise and her facial expression that makes this really one of the best pieces in the shop. Congratulations to Nick. I'm sorry, to Yoming. Is she here? Okay. So now we're coming to the finale. This is a piece, actually, it's an ink on paper, a radiograph pen. It is pretty large, 25 by 30 inches. Its title is Memory April by Catherine Felice, I believe. You know, when you look it on screen, it's a different response than if you look in person. When we went to see the pieces yesterday, when I looked at this close, there was something that was missing in the JPEG. It was the texture and the lines. There are these delicacy of these curvilinear lines drawn one after another carefully next to each other. And these lines define the musculature of the form, the woman figure, and the suggestion of the hand, anonymous hand that comes into the space and lifts the chin of the figure as to look at me or listen. And then floating petals, either floating from her head. What's interesting, the first thought I did without even looking at the label, I thought it was a engraving or a etching, because it has that technique. And it kind of reminds me back to the days pre-Renaissance, like Albert Durer, when he would use lines to define the form rather than using lines to define shadow and light. And what's wonderful is the white space is just as activated, and the rhythm of the forms really create a very cohesive arrangement. And so it was kind of a stunning moment, and to say, yeah, of this piece, we didn't think it would be best of show, became best of show when we saw an actual person. So we have, I believe, Catherine online.
I'm here.
Hello, Catherine. Congratulations.
Thank you.
I just want to spend a couple minutes with you to talk about this piece, and if you can answer a couple questions. I know the delicacy of the lines, and as artists and any artist, when you start off the image, you know, you have the luxury of starting with a sketch and building up the surface, and be able to, if you make a mistake, you can change it. In this case, there's very little room for change. And I was wondering, how do you start making this piece?
Well, first of all, thank you, everyone. I'm still, you can tell, in shock a little bit. And Rick, love your work. For me, I do just a hand sketch. I try to use a model. This one is modeled actually after my daughter. And I just do a sketch, and then I use a light table to transfer just the outline. And then I freehand all of the ink lines using a meditative flow. And I just do.
So could you explain the concept behind this drawing?
Yes, this is called Memory April. The whole series of Memory is about sort of excavating my past and really narration about how we are formed by our memories and how we challenge ourselves through our memories, but then how we also release our memories. And Memory April is probably the most uplifting piece I've created in all of my work, and especially in the Memory series, because this piece in particular represents the happiest day of my life, my best memory.
Very well. You're a well-established artist, multi-talented. Notice that you have shows all over the world, solo shows, and that you also are a graphic designer. You have your own company, I believe, for 20 years. You're from Gilroy. Yes. Is that where you grew up?
I was born in Arizona, and area, but my husband is from Gilroy, so that's how I landed here.
So how do you, between your work, between your artwork and your work for pay?
I work 4 days a week in the office, and then my children are grown, and so I have a lot of free time. So I draw at night and weekends, and sometimes I take really long lunches and draw. So I get 30, 40 hours a week of drawing in.
And when you come up with these images, do you just sketch them in a sketchbook, or do you spend time just coming up with, you got like a encyclopedia of images that you can pick from?
I spend a lot of time thinking and learning and collecting images and taking pictures. I'm good with better with a reference. So I have a compilation, and then when I have an idea, I try to find an image that helps me form it in my head. But primarily it's just free sketching.
And if there's a moment, though, I'm sure it's happened to all of us, there is a mistake.
Oh gosh. Yeah.
So what do you do with that? In this case, which, you know, you can't really erase it.
You can't. There's something kind of scary when you put the first line down, but because I just sort of let go, I don't know how I do it exactly with the way my hand knows where I want it to go. It just does. Very occasionally I slip out, and honestly, I just have to start over, because I can't erase it and I don't want to use whiteout. So, but it's remarkable how little I slip, to be honest.
And finally, what type of paper do you use?
I use Strathmore 500 plate.
Okay.
Only a rapidograph pen. This is just a 0.35, just one.
Great. Pen. Again, congratulations for the best of show. You have a solo show at the Pacific Art League.
Sweet.
A date to be determined. So, I mean, that's, I mean, I had that opportunity when I got into the salon show at at the Triton and getting the best of show, you get the solo show there. And so you'll probably be working with Donnie on terms of time and space. And I look forward to seeing the show. It's incredible body of work that I've seen in your website. And to all the artists who have submitted their work, I mean, they're in this difficult time. I just have one word to all of you, other than hope, is persistence. This is a great opportunity to jury the show. I want to thank everyone who was part of the show, Kate Culpepper, the committee, Donnie, my co-juror, and also to Allie, the marketing director, who's done a fabulous job of putting a marketing and branding the Pacific Art Lake. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Rick. Thank you, Trin Wei. Congrats to all the artists, and thank you for participating in this show. Again, please, if you want to support this exhibit, you can do so by just visiting Pacific Art League, grab a cup of coffee and have a stroll in front of the building. It's really beautiful. Again, all the artworks are online and are on in the online gallery and for sale. If you have any sale inquiries, you can contact Donnie Foley. That's donnie@pacificartleague.org. Again, you can sign up to be a PAL member or take a class. And please consider donating to our Fund in Need. Again, all donations from tonight, over $25, and memberships will be sent a commemorative poster from tonight. So before we leave, we have a video slideshow of the exhibit. If you would like to stay, please join us and watch. Otherwise, you can also access the gallery on our website. So Donnie is going to play the video. Thank you.
Thank you.